Good evening. Welcome to Shepherd of the Valley's Thanksgiving Eve service. We'll be following the special order of worship that is printed out for you in the service folder. It will also be visible for you on the screens. We hear through this Psalm 100 the many reasons we have for giving thanks to the Lord. We'll begin our worship this evening with hymn 609. We'll sing the three stanzas. We praise you, O God, our Redeemer, Creator, in grateful devotion our tribute we bring. We lay it before you, we kneel and adore you, we bless your holy name, in glad praises we sing. We worship you, God of our fathers, we bless you. Through trial and tempest, our guide you have been. When perils o'ertake us, you will not forsake us. And with your help, O Lord, our battles we win. With voices united, our praises we offer to you, great Jehovah, glad anthems we raise. Your strong arm will guide us, our God, it is beside us. To you, our great Redeemer, forever be praised. Please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Father,
your generous goodness comes
to us new every day. By the work of your Spirit, lead us to acknowledge your goodness, give thanks for your benefits, and serve you in willing obedience. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. We continue with the responsive litany for Thanksgiving. The Lord opens his hand and satisfies the desire of every living creature.
The Lord has opened his hand, and our community and animals, and provided for all.
The Lord created man and woman and breathed into them breath of life. The Lord has provided the gift of marriage and family. The Lord has provided government, schools, and businesses. The Lord has provided us with his house of worship. Here, the Lord also blesses us with the sacrament of baptism.
Here we are reminded of our baptismal blessings as we see others
baptized. Here, the Lord provides the sacrament of Holy Communion.
Here we come to the altar and receive our Savior's body and blood, which assures us of forgiveness and the promise of eternal life in heaven.
The Lord is preparing a place for us at His side in eternity. We have not always thanked the Lord for His many wonderful blessings. You are forgiven through our Lord Jesus Christ. Go in peace. Give thanks unto the Lord, for He is good, and His mercy endures forever. Amen. Please be seated. We'll join in the singing of Psalm 100. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord a new song. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before Him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is He who made us, and we are His. We are His people, the sheep of His pasture. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord a new song. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and praise His name. For the Lord is good and His love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord a new song. You may remain seated for tonight for the gospel reading. This is the Thanksgiving gospel for our scripture reading from the Gospel of St. Luke, chapter 17, verses 11 and following. We're going to hear about 10 men who are deathly ill. All 10 are healed by Jesus. One man comes back and gives thanks to God for what Jesus had done for him, for the gift of his physical health. But we notice something else about the man. Jesus says that this man has faith. And we might think, well, that's what saved him as far as his health goes, but that's not the case. His faith had given him trust in Jesus as the Messiah, but he had been given the gift of salvation, which was even greater than his healing. For our physical and spiritual blessings, we give thanks. Now, on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." When he saw them, he said, "Go, show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw he was healed, came back praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, "Were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Rise and go. Your faith has made you well." This is the word of our Lord, the Thanksgiving Gospel. We'll now join in the singing of hymn 612. We'll sing the three stanzas. Our days, bounteous source of every joy, let your prayers our tongue employ. All to you, our God, we owe. Source whence all our blessings flow. The plenty summer pours, autumn's rich o'erflowing stores, flocks that whiten all the plain, yellow sheaves of ripened grain. Lord, for these our souls we raise grateful vows and solemn praise. Peace, prosperity, and health, private bliss and public wealth, knowledge with its gladdening streams, true religion's holier beams. Lord, for these our souls shall raise grateful vows and in the name of the Lord Jesus, we begin our meditation. The Word of God, as you can see, Psalm 100, I'll be introducing that now. Dear Lord, bless our meditation that we might ever have thankful hearts as we see your great blessings. Amen. Dear friends in Jesus, the Lord, through the Apostle Paul, calls on you and me to be thankful, but here's the thing, to be thankful always. I have his words in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 17 and 18, where it says, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Now maybe you just hesitated there for a moment in your thoughts. Wait a minute. I'm supposed to continually give praise and thanks to the Lord through 2020, this year, with all the stuff going on? Yes. I have a person who will help us maybe to understand, because this is where I'm going to come from this evening, that we give thanks in all circumstances. Think of Noah. You remember Noah in the Bible. He built the ark. The great flood came. What is the first thing that Noah did after he got off the ark? And the answer is found in chapter 8 of Genesis, verse 20. Noah built an altar to the Lord, and taking some of all the clean animals and clean birds, he sacrificed burnt offerings on it. All of humanity, all his neighbors, all his acquaintances, all the people of his community, they were all dead. And the landscape of the earth was gone and changed drastically. And he had to live through that, ride out the storm. And yet, the first thing he does when he gets off the ark is to give thanks to God. Why? Well, first of all, he was alive, and he and his wife and family, they're breathing. Secondly, the landscape of his front yard had changed quite a bit, but he had a place to live. He had a home. And more than anything else, because Noah had been one of those people to proclaim the name of the Lord, he was a preacher of righteousness, Noah had the promise of the Savior in his heart. He knew someday God was going to have from his family tree a Savior born who would not only fix his relationship with God, bring him forgiveness and peace, but open the gates to heaven. And he believed in that firmly. And so his heart was overflowing with thankfulness. Again, I'm setting that as the backdrop tonight, as we come here to worship and to give thanks in all circumstances of life, even in 2020. We have material blessings, which we've richly been blessed with this year. We have spiritual blessings in the Lord Jesus. And to help us and guide us in our thanksgiving, I have Psalm 100. And from verse 1 there, it says, a song for giving thanks, shout for joy to the Lord all the earth. This is the Thanksgiving Psalm in the Bible. And this, we're going to take our theme from that first verse, shout for joy to the Lord. As we go through this, we'll see the reasons that we have for giving thanks. So, we will go to the part one now of four parts, and we shout for joy to the Lord because he has made us. And this is the first part of verse 3. Know the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people. As you know, people are gathering all over the country to celebrate, maybe in smaller groups this year, but people look at their family and the things they have, and some feel grateful. But who are they giving thanks to? As you and I gather in church to worship, we are giving thanks, and we know who we are giving thanks to. The psalm writer reminds us, know the Lord is God. We know the Lord from the Bible. The Lord is that name which reminds us that God is alive. He is the living God, and he has been living for a very, very long time. But here's the neat thing. He's not just interested in living. He's interested in giving life. And he has given life to you and to me and to all people. If we get up in the morning and we're walking and talking and breathing and moving and even having fun, thank God. God has given us that life. But that's not the only thing life he's given us. He's given us a very special kind of life inside of us that we didn't used to have. I'm going to turn you to the words of Paul in Ephesians 2, verse 3. All of us also lived among all them at one time, that's the people of the world, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. Our nature, when it was conceived and born, was corrupt. Many of us are blessed to be born into good families, and many of us are born into Christian families. But I have a thought for you here. Even though you might have been born into a good family or a Christian family, you were not a Christian when you were born. You were not good in your core. You were a little heathen. I was too. That's the way we're born into this world. That's what Paul is talking about. But God has loved us nevertheless. St. Paul goes on in chapter 2, now verses 4 and 5 I have up on the screen. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. We gather at Thanksgiving and we worship because of this. This is the main reason. We were born into this world dead to God, but Jesus was born into this world alive to him and lived every moment for him and died for his Father and for us, that we might have through his life and death the forgiveness of every one of our sins and the promise of life. Now you have life right now. God has a relationship with you. You know him, and the more you go in the Bible, the more you learn of him and realize what a great God he is, and ultimately we're going to have everlasting life. For these things, for life, we give thanks. We'll continue now with the singing of hymn 610. We'll sing the stanzas in the bulletin.
Thank you.
all our God with hearts and hands and voices. Oh, wondrous things has done, in whom his world rejoices. Oh, from our mother's arms has blessed us on our way with countless gifts of love, and still is ours today. Oh, may this bounteous God through all our life be near us, with ever joyful hearts and blessed peace to cheer us, and keep us in his grace, and guide us when perplexed, and free us from all ills in this world and the next. All praise and thanks to God the Father now be given. The Son and him who reigns with them in highest heaven. The one eternal God, whom heaven and earth adore. For thus it was, is now, and shall be evermore. We shout for joy to the Lord because he feeds us. Verse 3, the last part of it, the sheep, we are the sheep of his pasture. Some of you have probably heard of this book by W. Philip Keller, A Shepherd Looks at Psalm 23. He was a shepherd early in life, a Christian man, and I noticed he's got a lot more books, so he may not be doing a lot of shepherding right now. But I was never a shepherd, so I appreciate his wisdom. One of the things that he talks about in his book is that the sheep sit there at the green grass, and they'll eat it, and they'll eat it all the way down to the roots. And the shepherd needs to move them on so they don't ruin it, so the grass can't grow back. But he says if the shepherd neglects the sheep and leaves them there, they'll eat it all up till there's nothing, and then they'll just stay there. You and I might be able to see a green patch of grass not too far away, but they're not that smart. The shepherd needs to move them and make sure that they continue to feed and have sustenance. In the Bible, we are called sheep, and the Lord is very happily our shepherd. Now, very often we use a spiritual application here, but I'm going to add this tonight, that Jesus does feed us with our daily bread, and I would say with a vast variety of food, not just quantity, which we tend to have here in the United States, but variety. We are so blessed. We can give thanks to the Lord for that. But if we stop there, that would be a poor interpretation of Psalm 23 and what the Lord has in mind for us. We need to have our souls fed. And that is to have the love of God, the grace and power of God in our hearts, and that comes through the Word and the sacraments. That's how God spiritually feeds us. That's what you're doing here tonight at church. You're getting a spiritual feeding. Now, you and I might say, is that really necessary? I feel good in my body. Yeah, but do you get stressed out? Do you feel guilty? I'll tell you about something. Once in a while, when we used to have a potluck, when we were able to do that, I noticed somebody brought a beautiful tray of deviled eggs. But there's about 12 of them, and you know, they're beat and they're all pretty and they taste great. And the only thing is with only about 10 or 12 on the platter, if you were one of the last people through the line, or if you wanted to take one and then come back for seconds, forget it. You didn't have a chance. The deviled eggs were gone. So inside of us, we might say, you know what, maybe I should grab 3 or 4 or 5 or 6. Have you ever done that? Maybe not here in church in front of everybody, but when you were a kid at a picnic, did you grab too many brownies, a couple cans of soda, and then later have a tummy ache? We in our sinful nature have this really bad habit and sin of worrying, of being afraid we're not going to get enough of our favorite foods, and we just grab stuff when we shouldn't, and perhaps others don't even get to have some because we grab too much. I think you know what I'm talking about. This is where spiritual food becomes such a blessing to us, because we do sin, we do make mistakes, sometimes very unintentionally. But we go to the pastures of God's Word, the green pastures of the Word of God, the clear, cool waters of the gospel. And what do we hear from our God? What our mom and dad probably told us, shame on you when we were little. You shouldn't have taken all that food. No, we hear, I'm glad you repented. I'm glad you're sorry. Here is the forgiveness of sins. And when it's with communion, it's with, the Lord says, here's my own body and blood given and shed for you at the cross. That's a spiritual feeding. What does that do? It takes away the guilt. It takes away the anxiety and the stress even. Because I realize, yeah, there's always going to be plenty of food around. God's going to take care. And I have this peace in my heart which comes from that. So for the physical feedings that God gives us, of which maybe tomorrow we'll enjoy a Thanksgiving meal of some kind, and the spiritual feedings that we get every time we turn to the Word and the sacraments, we thank the Lord. We shout for joy. We'll join in the singing of the next hymn based on Psalm 23. Shout for joy to the Lord. He continues to take care of us. Here, verse 5, for the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. I want to read to you a portion or a summary of President Abraham Lincoln's Thanksgiving Proclamation. And I do have that. I hope it's big enough print, but there's a little bit of it there. We have been, Lincoln says, the recipients of the choicest bounties of heaven. We have grown in numbers, wealth, and power as no other nation has grown, talking about our country. But we have forgotten God. We have forgotten the gracious hand which preserved us in peace and multiplied and enriched and strengthened us. And we have vainly imagined in the deceitfulness of our hearts that all these blessings were produced by some superior wisdom and virtue of our own. Intoxicated with the unbroken success, we have become too self-sufficient to feel the necessity of redeeming and preserving grace, too proud to pray to the God that has made us. And with this, the larger proclamation, what he said was that he was designating the fourth Thursday of November to be a day in which people should give thanks throughout the land. It was the Lord who led many Christians to our country. It was either because of need, because of the farming or issues like that, or it was before they were to be able to express their faith and live their faith and weren't able to do it in the old land, they came over here. And many of our ancestors were among them. But one of the things that had to happen is this land had to sustain them or it would have been for nothing, right? And Lincoln, that's why I read his proclamation, or part of it anyway, is that we've been the recipients of the choicest bounties of heaven. The people growing in numbers, the land so fruitful that there was reason for him to say this, that we ought to give thanks. Now, again, I take us back to 2020. We think about the fact that we've had to wear masks, that sometimes finding toilet paper in the store is a little bit of a headache, perhaps other things, perhaps worries about your health, an election, of course, always natural disasters and issues like that. And we think, but I don't feel very thankful. And I think, again, I use the example of Noah, and now I'm going to Abraham Lincoln. Think of when he made that proclamation. It's 1863. Middle of a civil war that was tearing apart our country, was bloody and messy, and he says, we live in a really bountiful land. We should be giving thanks. I'm going to proclaim a day of thanksgiving. Shouldn't we be giving thanks today? Of course. Psalm 100 reminds us of this, that you have it there in verse 5. He is good. The Lord is good. His love endures. His faithfulness continues throughout all generations. A part of our thankfulness is giving thanks for his constant care and help, which he does give. We'll join in the singing of the next hymn.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound, that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace has brought me safe. gave thus far, and grace will lead me home. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no last days to sing in God's praise than when we first begun.
Shout for joy to the Lord, part four now. He loves it when we give thanks. Two verses here, 2 and 4. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. I can only imagine what was in the mind of the pilgrims as they approached Jerusalem, singing Psalm 100. There at the top of Jerusalem, the crowning glory, the temple, and not just that it was one of the beautiful buildings in the world, it was a place where they could gather to worship. God was there in the Holy of Holies, present there to hear their prayers, there to bless their worship. It's no wonder that we read about Psalm 100 that they very likely used this on the road. They couldn't wait to get to Jerusalem to worship and sing. They were singing on the way there. And that kind of reminds me of our Easter celebrations. I have pictures up there from Easter Sunday, the altar with all the beautiful flowers, the children in their pretty clothes and the baskets for the Easter egg hunt, some people enjoying fellowship. People dress up for Easter. Why? Because we come, it's a very, very happy time. We get excited because of the reason for our joy. And it's the same reason why they went to the temple. We know that we have a God of life. We know that in that plan, the God of life has a Savior for us, Jesus. They were looking forward to his coming. We know that he has already come and we are waiting his second coming. As we enter his courts, we're filled with joy. I'm sure that as you worship here, not just tonight, but over the weeks and months throughout the year, you're giving thanks to God because he is so good to you. Now, I want to add one little thing. It has to do with the council meeting that we had Monday night. We always try to begin our council meetings with a devotion, and because it's this week, I said, what are you guys thankful for? And you can't say God and you can't say Jesus because I did that in the devotion. I said, what are you thankful for? And it was a beautiful list. It was really neat. The guys stepped up. They talked about family, spouse, health, opportunities to receive communion during COVID. For a little while, we had some issues, but we were able to do it. Even a story of sharing the faith with someone. Our guys were thankful, and we had prayers of thanks to God for the things that the Lord has done for us and for his church throughout the year. With that illustration, I want to point something out to you, and that is that it's not just here in church that we give thanks. We gave thanks in that meeting. You can give thanks in your home as you go about your chores, doing your things. You can even think of the Lord and as you're running errands and give thanks in your heart to God, especially in the way you approach others, in the way you talk, in the way you act. Every day is a day of thanksgiving, a day where you and I can shout for joy to the Lord, just like the psalmist. Amen. May the peace of God that surpasses all understanding keep your hearts and minds thankful and in Christ Jesus. Amen. We have our offering plates. We will not pass the offering plate, but you can drop your gift in there now or in the future. We will continue with having you rise and stand, and we will sing the song, the hymn that follows, hymn 484. Please rise. Brothers, sisters, let us gladly give to God all our best. Serve as hearty,
thorough honest, with our living love impressed. All our duty, all our striving, all our time to Him belong. Praise Him then with true devotion, come before Him with a song. By His mercy, by His bounty, by the gift of Christ our Son, every goodness He has shown us, what high marvels He has done. Let us to Him promptly, freely yield our bodies and our souls, thankful that His love protect us, that His wisdom all controls.
Let us pray. O dearest Heavenly Father, You have been opening Your hand and pouring out Your gifts, meeting the desires and needs and beyond that of every living creature. Even in this year of 2020, we have so much to be thankful for. And one of the signs of that, Lord, is that we're here in Your house, able to worship You. You've blessed us with enough health to do that. There are also people at home worshiping, some whose health been as great, and yet they are hearing Your word and they are worshiping You. We also pray, O Lord, that You would continue to bless those who even can't necessarily listen to this service from home, but continue to be with Your servants here on earth as we live and breathe and carry Your name. We thank You that daily and weekly You've supplied food for our bellies. You have given us every needed thing, from transportation to medicine to jobs to retirement savings, and bless those savings to earn income. Even in difficult times, You have been here with Your hand of blessing. We praise and thank You, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, for Your rich generosity. Keep our eyes open to this generosity. But at the same time, Lord, we confess that You have even been done greater blessings for us. When we were lost and in the blindness of unbelief, You brought us through the waters of holy baptism. You brought Your word to us and gave us faith, and You made us Your own, that we can be here tonight and say, what a great God we have. What a great and wonderful Savior we have, who gave His all on Calvary's cross for us. Thank You, Jesus, for being our brother and Savior, living here with us and dying for us and rising again. And thank You for opening the gates of heaven and the mansions there for us to go and live with You someday and to enjoy Your hospitality in heaven. Keep us in the faith. Help us to be ever thankful in our hearts. Help us to live thankful lives and bring more and more of the people of our country who live here to be thankful and to give praise and thanks to You as the psalm writer did of old. We pray this all in the name of Jesus with thankful hearts, and now we join together in praying. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Receive the blessing once more of the Lord. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. You may be seated for the closing hymn.
Children with my blessing, never alone. Waking, sleeping, I am with you, you are my own. In my love's baptismal river, I have made you mine forever. Go, my children, with my blessing, you are my own. Go, my children, sins forgiven, at peace and pure. Here you loved how much I love you, what I can cure. Here you heard my dear son's story. Go, Jim saw his glory. Go, my children, sins forgiven, at peace and pure. Go, my children, fed and nourished, closer to me. Grow in love and love by serving, joyful and free. Here my spirit's power filled you. Here his tender comfort stilled you. Go, my children, fed and nourished, joyful and free. The Lord will bless and keep you and give you peace. I, the Lord, will smile upon you and give you peace. I, the Lord, will be your Father, Savior, Comforter, and Brother. Go, my children, fed with you, and give you peace.
I want to thank everyone for coming tonight and also for watching online. And I want to wish everyone a very happy and blessed and safe Thanksgiving holiday. I'm going to have you turn it off, John.